page down. It's really hard to see. Things to discuss: the memory model, atomics, and what you can but shouldn't do with them. And hopefully by the end of this, you'll know everything you need to know about memory model and atomics. And everything you need to know is use locks. Don't worry about the memory model. Okay. Don't use atomics. Yes, talk is over. That's all you need to know. But if you're, you know, for the curious, let's try to figure out what the memory model is all about. When I like to describe computers to friends that aren't into computers at all, I say, really, they're simplest things you can imagine. It's like a piece of paper with a pencil, and you can write on it, and then it follows really, really basic instructions, like a simple game. And the only weird thing about it is the instructions for the game are also part of the memory, part of the piece of paper, and even where, you know, the instruction pointer, where you are in the game, where you are in the instructions, that's part of the memory. Everything's folded into the memory. But, you know, that's how an if statement works. It changes the memory, so it jumps to a new place. For our purposes, it's not so much about how the instructions work. It's just, I'm going to claim this is the memory model as you need to know it, right? But as it turns out, the memory model is not that simple. It's not just a piece of paper with a pencil on it. It's a slightly more complicated. You have, like, you know, maybe layers of memory caches and stuff, and the rules are much more complicated than snakes and ladders. You know, that's closer to the memory model. But really, the memory model is more like this. You've got, like, maybe 16 processors, 16 Spocks all playing chess at the same time. In this diagram, you know, I've got them all looking exactly the same. Maybe that's my poor Photoshop skills or something. Right, oh, yeah. 16 Spocks we have here. You know, if you recall the last Star Trek movie, there were two Spocks in the last Star Trek movie, two concurrent Spocks. So I predict that the next movie coming out will have 16 Spocks, and that's based on Moore's Law, right? So it's been 4 years or whatever since, and so it's doubled three times, and we should have 16 Spocks for this next movie coming out. And if you really want to keep track, in 68 there was two Spocks for a short period. One was good, one was evil, had the mustache and beard and stuff. And in 1984, the Genesis Project, there was like 1.5 Spocks. But, you know, we should get 16 in the next one. Anyhow, it's always good to have graphs in slides. So, you know, here's my, let's pretend I've got these all looking the same because of cache coherency, you know, where, and I mention cache coherency because if you go, the thing to do for this kind of stuff is go on a comp programming threads or someplace like that and ask stupid questions, and you'll just get trashed. It's terrible. I don't go there. It's very scary to ask questions there because people always say, you're always worried about, you know, I set X over here, does the other processor see X and stuff like that? And they always say, oh, the problem is the caches. You know, it's in the cache, that's why he doesn't see the other value. Yet all the processors we use basically have cache coherency. So that's not exactly the problem. So if you go on comp programming threads, never talk about the cache and as the cache being the problem, right? It's not where the problem is. So, you know, maybe this picture is because of cache coherency, not because of my Photoshop skills. So we can imagine that we've got this, but that really the memory's in the back there, and it's one big bank of memory. And we have our Spock writing to the memory, but the problem is we've got, you know, 16 Spocks writing to memory all at the same time. And we could have a case like this where Spock is making a heart shape or something, you know, like, or probably writing to two locations at the same time. Or we have, you know, two Spocks deadlocked, each trying to read or write at the same time, or doing an MC Escher painting, I'm not sure which. And speaking of deadlocks, the internet is the most amazing place, as we all know. I needed a picture of, because I didn't want to draw it myself, of cars deadlocking on left turns, right? Because technically, by law, blocking an intersection is against the law. And why is it against the law? It's because the people who made the laws understand concurrency and deadlocking, and that if you this guy blocks an intersection, this guy can't turn. This guy backs up. This guy backs up. He blocks the intersection. This guy can't turn. no one can go anywhere. That's why you don't block intersections, right? And it turns out I just searched for this image and found it. And it also found a blog that was on concurrency stuff. It was kind of a decent blog. So I thank that guy for doing my job, making slides for me. Where are we next? Oh, right. So it's not even as simple as 16 Spocks and everything. It's much more complicated. And this is why it's not a cache problem, but dig into why we get into these problems of concurrency. Basically, once upon a time, back in the first generation, Star Trek, the original series, computers were probably, the memory and the CPU were roughly the same speed, right? So there was no problems there, but CPUs have gotten faster. Memory's gotten faster, but CPUs have gotten way faster so that they're like 100 times faster than main memory. So what's the CPU supposed to do when it wants to write a value and then get on with its work? It doesn't wait for memory. What it tends to do is it stuffs the write events into a little write queue and says, oh yeah, write that to memory later. I gotta keep processing, I can't wait for you. So it's not even in the cache yet. It's actually in like the memory bus or somewhere like that. So that's one of the things a CPU might be doing. Or it might be doing speculative execution where up here it can read Z before it even bothers to read X because it's like, well, I'll look ahead. Maybe I might need that Z even before I do the if statement. And up at the top there, it could decide to reorder those things because once it gets into this cache, it can write them out to memory in whatever order it wants. And the other problem being, even when you read memory, it doesn't necessarily go down to here to read memory. It goes, you know what, you were just writing that memory. I haven't written out yet. So I'm just going to read it back out of here. So if you write something and then read it again, you'll just get the old value you wrote, not what's really in memory. And none of that has to do with the cache. So really, they can have no cache, and you still have all these problems. It's all in the architecture. And why can a CPU do all these things? Because the rule with the CPU, I don't even know if I have this slide yet or not. No, the rule with the CPU is, and it's like the as-if rule in a compiler, right? Do whatever you want, as long as you don't change the meaning of the program. Except for the rule for the CPU is, pretend you're the only CPU in the house and do whatever you want. Forget that there's another CPU right beside you. And it's odd because it obviously knows there's another CPU there, right? But the rule with processors is, no, ignore all the other CPUs and just run as if you're the only one. And that's great because they run a lot faster that way and they don't have to worry about what's going on with the other CPUs. Of course, that causes problems in your code when you're running your code on two CPUs. So we'll have to fix that problem. So basically, this is the memory model, in reality. It's not just a scrap of paper graph paper. It's more like this. So this is the memory model we want, right? Nice and simple, do a write, do another write, use the one pencil. And this is the memory model that we have. To be clear, the reason we want this is because it's understandable, right? And you don't have to worry about what happened between steps. But this is what we have. This is what we want, and this is what we have. But as it turns out, this is also what we want, because basically, got to get my props out here now. So it's like Star Trek. Chekhov, on screen. Mr. Sulu, warp factor one. What is it? Mr. Spock, these sensors, what are the readings? Fascinating, Captain. It appears I can't use the sensors while Mr. Chekhov is using the pencil. Because you only have one pencil to work with. Scotty, we need more pencils right away. But Captain, if we got more pencils, we won't know what's going on. The whole ship will be in chaos. Scotty, we need those pencils. Aye, Captain. Stardate log, unknown. Seems the ship is in chaos and it can't even tell me the date anymore. The engineers are having problems programming the ship. Everything is in chaos. And worse yet, the audience is getting sick of my skits and wants me to get back to the presentation. Anyhow, that's, I practiced that all day, you know. The worst part is I haven't looked at my slides for a couple of months, so I forget everything except for that. That's the only part I remember. So we would like to have this simple model that we can understand and program with, but we want the speed of this other model. And basically what we want is sequential consistency, something logical, and speed. And we want our cake and we want to eat it too. So what is sequential consistency? Sequential consistency is, you know, to be a little more precise about it, is all memory reads and writes of all threads executed as if interleaved into some global order consistent with the program order of each thread. What the heck does that mean? That means you've got this thread doing its instructions and this thread doing its instructions, and they're independently running, and you think, well, how could those two threads mix? They could mix in any way, right? You could have, you know, a little Spock thing there, and you know, these instructions, then these two, and then these ones, and these ones. You can mix them anyway, but you'll never mix them where these fingers get crossed or like this into there, because that would be inconsistent on the one thread. So you'll never get that, or some, you know, each thread goes in order, but you don't know how they're interleaved. And that is sequential consistency. That just means when you look at your code, all you have to do is imagine every line of code, and after that line, any line in the other thread could have happened. And then after that line, any line in the other thread could have happened. And just put all the possible combinations of all the instructions in your threads, and then you have no problem, right? So here's a diagram of my hands. Basically, this thread does ABC, alpha, beta, gamma, and you could mix them up in any of these orders, but ABC always happens in order, alpha, beta, gamma, you know, they'll never get mixed up. An individual thread will work as expected. And that's kind of cut off, but we'll see what we can do here. To get even more details on what sequential consistency is like, this is like a syntax I got off the internet from this guy. Imagine there's, it's kind of cut off here, but there's, these are four processors, right? And the two processors are going to do their writes. One's going to write a 1 to x, one's going to write a 2 to x, and these other two processors in the middle are going to read x and see what they get. Okay? That's the general form of the syntax. So imagine that the processor in reality did this. It wrote 1, it, you know, read this, these threads read 1, it wrote 2, blah, blah, blah. You can, that makes a complete sense that that's how it happened, right? Well, we can see, think it happened like this way, and we see it happen like this way, but really, it could have happened in this order. If you could actually see, you know, open up the computer, look at the instructions, look at memory as it's happened, what each CPU did, it could have happened in this order, but you will figure out that it must have happened in that order. And even though it happened in this order, it's still sequentially consistent because it's as if they were interleaved. They could have interleaved like that, but you see it like that, and that's the as-if rule, right? So it's kind of like, this side here is, imagine you have a probe where here's your four processors, here's your memory, and you've got a probe right on where the memory gets written and read and read. This probe can tell you that this is what really happened, but you know, you don't get to have that probe. The only probe you get is your processors and what they show, right? You can look at, you could print out the lines or whatever. So you've got four probes on the side, and as long as those four probes look consistent, you will get something that makes sense, right? And basically there's the pencil, the one pencil. And as long as it looks like one pencil wrote it, it doesn't matter how many pencils actually did the writing. And another example, same idea, if this happened, you would see it as if it must have been this. This must have written first, and then these, and that, regardless of what order it really happened in. And so those are happy. And then if you got this, and this guy wrote, first processor wrote 1, second processor wrote 2, and then we got these reads, what really happened? What do you perceive as happening? You perceive that it must have been in that, or that's the order it happened in. Right? Does that make sense? Good. So that one's happy. Now, imagine we see this. This guy writes one, this guy reads one, he reads two, two and one, and blah, blah, blah. Now you try to think backwards, okay, how did that come to be, right? If you look at just these three processors, you'll say, oh, that looks like this case. It must have been write, the first processor wrote, then the guy read, and then the other processor wrote, and then he read again, right? And if you look at this one, you go, oh, that's this case. But when you look at them both together, you're like, wait a second, I can't order these in any order such that I would get that result. So basically what you're saying is, back to this, it's like you've got four witnesses at the crime scene who say, this is what happened. I saw the ambulance arrive, and then I saw the fire truck arrive. And the other guy's, no, I saw the fire truck arrive, and then I saw the ambulance arrive. And you're like, okay, something's inconsistent here. Somebody's lying. Something's not right. So that's sequentially inconsistent. Now, there's nothing stopping processors from doing this. But it's sequentially inconsistent. Yes?
Are you saying that sequentially consistent means there is such an order, but it doesn't specify which order it is?
Yeah.
Can you repeat that question?
Sequential consistency specifies there is an order, doesn't specify which order it is. Yes. And basically it says, don't worry what order it happened in, as long as you can figure out a consistent order that makes sense, then assume it happened in that order. That's the as if part of it. But at the bottom of it all, the computers aren't sequentially consistent. We want to add sequential consistency on top of the processors because they're allowed to do that crazy stuff, but we can't reason about our programs when they do. So that's not sequentially consistent, and we don't like that. But, you know, maybe that's okay sometimes. Maybe it's like, yeah, you know, I really don't, you know. Yeah, well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man. That's, you know, relax and don't try to make it all consistent between all the processors. Just let them all run off on their own. Because sometimes that might not be important for the logic of your program. Makes the logic of your program harder to figure out, but maybe it's okay. And let's just keep going here. So that's sequential consistency. And relaxed memory model, to be precise again, is 16 egotistical laid-back Spocks that don't care what the other ones think. But each Spock on its own is very internally consistent. They just don't care about the others. That's the relaxed model. That's the one where, you know, you get twos and ones that are out of order. That's not quite as precise as the other definition. So that's the memory model. And we'll learn some more about the memory model, but the best way to learn about that is to start using it and getting into atomics. And atomics are a way we're going to have our cake and eat it too. And careful, you baked it. So there's atomic. Let's start at the top. No. That is actually all of atomic, at least by the spec. It doesn't have any of the details in it. And this is sort of a tutorial. Let's take a look at what the atomic class is. So atomic is a template that takes a T. And the template is specialized in three ways. You've got the generic one at the top, a specialization for integral types, and a specialization for pointers. And we'll see how that works. And basically, an atomic you can store and you can load from it. And you've got these crazy memory models, or memory orderings that you can be very explicit about. And you've got all these variations of every function. Every function on atomics, there's the volatile version, the non-volatile version, and all the functions are no except. So, volatile. Volatile comes up all the time in like lock-free programming and stuff. And basically, volatile has nothing to do with threading, nothing to do with lock-free. Get it out of your brain. This is your program. This is, you know, the memory model. This is the memory of your program. Volatile is for out here. It's for when you need to get out of the, it's like the standard always talks about the not the virtual machine, but the, whatever the word is for that. The abstract machine, right? You're working inside the abstract machine. When you want to go outside the abstract machine and like print to standard out, that's volatile. Volatile is when you exit the machine and go out to the rest of the world, right? Volatile is not for in between threads, because between threads are inside the abstract machine. They're inside the memory. So, you know, my 16 Spocks, when they want to write outside the machine, then they use volatile. So anyhow, we've got volatile and no accept and all that kind of stuff. And I'll just erase all that and assume every function I talk about has a volatile version, and they're all no accept. I just don't want to type that ever again, right? And also in the atomic header file, there's that class atomic, but there's also these C-like functions that instead of working on this pointer, you pass in the object, and you know that's the C version, which I won't bother talking about anymore. And the C version gets really ugly because you get these functions like atomic compare exchange weak explicit, because there's no function overloading in C, and takes like 5 parameters. So let's not worry about the C version. Let's stick to the C++ version. So let's look. There's curly brackets here somewhere. Let's look at the atomic class for the general one for all cases, integrals, bool, and everything. It has a constructor. Doesn't have copy operations. Does anyone know why it doesn't have a copy constructor and copy assignment? Yeah, they're not atomic. So, like, don't give the impression that it would be atomic, right? So it's just like, no. If you want to read from one atomic and put it in the other, you have to use load and store to do it. It's got the load and store. It does have an assign from the underlying T type, and that can be atomic because it just calls store. And you can read it out. That's fine. And then it's got these funky exchange things that we'll definitely talk more about. And then it's got a function called isLockFree, because you can stick any T you want into an atomic, and your T can be 87 bytes, and that's not going to be lock-free. It's going to wrap a lock around that thing just to be atomic. And it actually gets really scary when you try to figure out how to do atomics on non-lock-free classes, because you have to do sequential consistency on big objects, and it gets a little scary. But let's just leave that for that for now. And there's this other thing, another struct called atomic flag, which is even smaller than the atomic template. And it has next to nothing. It has like a default constructor. It has no copy stuff. And all you can do is test and set it and clear it. You can't just read it. There's no load, and there's no store. If you want to set a value to it, you have to set a value and with test and set. And if you want to get a value out, you have to set the value to get the old value out. You can't just read it. You have to set a value and read the old value back. Basically, the atomic flag is the minimal atomic thing that implementation has to support to be C++11. You need to have this. It must be atomic. Is lock free equals true for this type. None of the other stuff has to be lock free. This is the only thing that the processor has to be able to do. So that's like the minimum. And basically, if you have this structure, you should be able to build all your locks and all your atomic classes and everything else just with this. I don't advise it. Wouldn't be fun, but it should be possible.
Spin lock.
Yeah, exactly. Spin lock. Test and set. Yep, things like that. So back to the big giant atomic class. Let's look at specializations for pointers and integrals. Well, you get these nice plus 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 equals and stuff. And even though there's no assignment from atomic to atomic, these are there and overloaded, because these are atomic operations. Because there's a lot of processors that can do that. An atomic, I mean, this is the general case of it. Processors can do atomic increments, so we expose that. And if it's an integral, you even get the atomic bitwise operators.
And if a certain processor doesn't support those,
then there will be locks inside of it.
Around everything.
Yeah, the whole You know, it's not just, you know, obviously it's not just a lock inside of here. It has to be a lock inside the whole atomic template for that type T, which is unfortunate. But yeah, everything supports this now. So everything. I think it was only a few years ago I worked on something that didn't. So it still happens. And that's the full class again. I don't know why I'm showing that again. Just and then we have. I wish I could read my own slides. I could read my slides here. I can see exactly what it looks like. That's awesome. This is just to shrink it down so we can focus on the parts we want to focus on here. All these compare exchange functions in the load have this crazy memory order that you pass in all over the place. And I kind of mentioned with sequential consistency, we want our cake and eat it too. You can say when you do an atomic operation, I want it to be sequentially consistent. Or you can say, no, man, I don't care. It's, I want it to be relaxed. And there's other kind of in-between memory orders.
Will it be a difference between using a full memory barrier? And
things like that, yes, exactly. So let's talk about what relaxed means. And we're going to talk about what happens before means, which hasn't shown up yet, but that happens before it shows up with the what all this memory order stuff means. So suddenly you'll notice this slide looks completely different than all my other slides. This slide is from IBM 2010. It's from BoostCon 2010, and I took it. It's from Michael Wong. He's the Canadian rep on the Standards Committee, so in some small way my taxes help pay for him, so I'm allowed to take. He said it was okay. So there's, you know, yeah, it's this is IBM 2010. So, oh yeah, his slide was originally called that. I'm going to call this slide the sequential consistency versus acquire release operations versus relaxed operations. So let's see if I can remember what I was talking about here. So the idea of what we want to do here is set this value, set x to true, set y to true, and then another thread over here is going to watch y, assume everything was 0 before we started. So we set x, we set y. As long as y is 0, it's just going to spin here. And then eventually it'll see that y is no longer 0, and it will then read x and increment z, which was 0. And we want to say there's no way at the end of this all that z could be 0. Does that make any sense at all? Awesome. Because, why does this make sense? Because this thread can't get anywhere until this thread gets to here. There's this connection between these two threads, right?
Does it depend where you read the z from?
Does it depend where you read the z from? What do you mean?
Where does the assert get
at? Ah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's on that side. I think I got it. Yeah. Which thread is this assert on? The assert's on that on the far thread. Because obviously this guy will come in after doing this. He just takes off, and that other thread hasn't finished yet. So, kind of describing that, and the key is the way that those two connect. And in the standard, this is where we get this synchronized with. Thing. And in the standard, it says an operation A synchronizes with operation B if A is a load, or sorry, if A is a store to some atomic variable M, and with particular memory order, order release or sequential, and B is a load from the same memory location with acquire or sequential, consistent. And if you've got all these things, then B has read the value that was stored by A. And note that that's release and require. So, right. If I just, these are atomics, I just do store, the default is sequentially consistent, right? But as it turns out, I can just make these release and acquire because it says so, basically. The standard says, you don't need full sequential consistency here. We can relax it a little bit and say, all this guy needs to do is release the value. And the other guy acquires the value. And basically, under the hood, that's a slightly it's a less expensive operation. And also conceptually, what you're trying to say is, I'm publishing this value. I'm going to release it out to the wild, and the other guy's acquiring, wants to acquire the value. So if you've got those things together, you've got the red arrow, and you've got sequential consistency. And the important part about sequential consistency is not just that we don't, all this says is that B reads the value stored by A. So all that guaranteed was that this will get the value that was in Y. It doesn't say anything about X. It just says Y, right? So we care that X is, you know, I don't just want to read the value that was stored by Y. I want to read, when I read X, I expect it to be this. Where does that come in? And, well, that was a sequential consistent store. But I'm going to say I can actually do relaxed store on those two, on the X, and a relaxed read on the X. And I've still got this sequential consistency across the Y. And basically the idea is, we know that X, this X ends up over here because this guy connected everything. He didn't just connect his values. He connected the history of this thread. Everything that's ever happened in this thread becomes visible into this thread as soon as he sees the value that was here. As soon as that sequential consistency happens, the future of this thread is tied, sees the history of that thread. And that's the important part. And the way that's written in the, I don't know if I have a slide for that. The way that's written in the standard says, you know, this is a happens before relation because it's on one thread. And this is a happens before relation because it's on one thread. And then we got the complicated happens before, and happens before is transitive. If A happens before B and B happens before C, then there's happens before all the way across. So that's why that works. And locks use acquire release. Locks don't use sequential consistency inside, because if you think of, you had a big lock around this and you unlocked it, and then this guy grabs the lock to read X, you know, X is protected by the lock. That's all you need to ensure that things inside your locks are seen by the next guy who grabs the lock. It does mean that just because you put a lock around something here doesn't mean the other guy's ever going to see it. He needs the same lock, right? You've got to have that common ground between the two of them. So that's kind of, we've got sequential consistency, it works. We've got acquire release, it works. And what about relaxed? Let's change this to relaxed. And we've got this arrow here, which is no longer true, right? So this assert will no longer happen. I don't know why I still have. Oh, right, yeah. This PS is over here for use locks. As soon as you do this, in your head you're thinking sequential consistency, right? That's the way we imagine. It's like we imagine the one memory, one pencil thing. I write X, I write Y, over here I wait for Y, and then I read X. If you don't have the one pencil anymore, and you just say, let's do it relaxed, what can happen is, I don't know if I have a slide for that. I can't remember my slides. Nope. Back up. What happens is, it's these two things can easily, this processor can reorder these if it wants, if you don't force it to be ordered, and that can be reordered. And basically, this read can happen before there, and this whole thing gets reordered. But you had a question.
Yeah, thanks. I was wondering about the previous slide where you talked about acquire release semantics for the atomic versus eventual consistency. Sequential consistency. Mm-hmm. Is that considered using a lock when you use that memory order? Or, I know that when you talk about whether something is lock free or not,
right.
I had the impression that atomics were sort of fell into the category of lock free, but with some other sneaky thing that makes it work. But now you've described the acquire release as having a sort of locking semantic about it. Is that still considered lock free when you use this approach?
So is this lock free? I summarize that whole question into, and you know, so and you mentioned about locks in there. Basically, locks are written with lock free atomics underneath, right? So if you take your atomics and build a lock out of it, it's not really lock free anymore, even though you're using atomics. But you end up using the same techniques a lot, and what you want to do in lock free stuff is basically what you want to do is you have a lock around a bunch of code, and you want to make that, you always want to make those small, right? Don't lock more than you need to. If you can make it so small that it's only one integer in there, throw away the lock and just atomic on that integer, right? So lock free, I don't know if I have definition of lock free. Lock free is when the other side, the other thread is not waiting for you. And the big importance about lock free is, say you're coming along and you grab a lock, or you make up your own locking scheme where, you know, even a spin lock, you know, it's not a real lock, you're just spinning on an atomic. So this comes along, you set the atomic to one, telling the other guy, the other threads, don't go here, I'm busy. And the other guy spins, right? And now you go do your work, right? This guy's waiting for you. And then the scheduler decides to stop you and put you aside, right? This other thread can't go anywhere. Like, you've totally stopped everything because the scheduler got in the way and both the threads stop, right? Lock free says you've got two threads running along and you do some crazy atomic stuff. And what you typically do is, I'm probably going to get into this later, but what you typically do is do things in such a way that I'll set a flag and do some stuff, but if I get unscheduled by the scheduler, you're not waiting for me. You can keep going. And what typically happens is you both end up working on the same pieces of memory, doing stuff, but you always have to make sure you know what, you can always look to see how far has the other guy got along in the path, and what's the state of things. And on every instruction you do, you don't know what the state of things are because another thread might have changed it on you. So you have to be very careful. And basically we'll see that. So, but the definition of lock free is one thread makes progress. You don't know which thread, but at least one makes progress. That's Hurley. Hurley has a definition of all these things.
Question, what the difference between the sequential consistency and the release acquire is? Because they seem to be sort of equivalent in the sort of ordering relationship.
Yes. What an awesome question. What's the difference between sequential consistency and acquire release? If only I had a slide for that. Oh, here we go.
What a surprise.
Yeah, now the hard part is me explaining this slide. So, let's see. Usually I have like things. This is another slide from IBM. If we get down to here, and we read y, what does that mean? And we see it to be zero. What does that mean? We can look backwards. So this is obviously x. That's y over there. This must be x over here. So we set x to true. We set y to true. And then two other threads come along. This one waits for x. That one waits for y. And they're basically, we don't know which one happened first. These guys are each going to wait for one of them. And then this guy succeeds and comes down here. If he comes down here, that means X must have happened, right? And, oh, right. So X has been changed, and I read Y, and this is going to get complicated. I think I'm going to hit the, how do I know this was first and that was second? Right. This hasn't happened yet, right? If I get a zero here, if I get a zero, that must not have happened, right? So this has to happen later. So when I see zero, I know this happened. I got past here. I read zero. Well, if I get to here, I know this happened. If I read zero from here, I know that hasn't happened. That's what I wanted to say. So if I see zero, I see X, and then I see Y. And easier explanation, same with the other one, right? If you see that one first, you know what happened in the other order. Therefore, what we're going to claim is Z will never be 0. right? Because if we saw X get set, then we can, Y hasn't been set. Or
but on the other one, when it does happen, you know that X has already happened, so you're saying that X, Z will be set.
Yeah, so they could both happen, Z could be 2, but we'll never get down here, get to the end of all this, without one of these things happening. Z can never be 0. Now, the question is sequential consistency. The question is, whoa, I guess that was the question. I think it comes up later, but that's, if you look at where the happens before relationship is, where is one guy reading, the lock or whatever, reading X, reading, you know, A, or what in the sequential consistency was M, right? One guy writes M, the other guy reads M, and if they see the same value and you got acquire release or sequential consistency, then they're locked together. That was the previous diagram. In this case, you will find no one memory location that they both synchronized on. There's no one synchronization point of this. It requires all the logic to get to this state. If you only have acquire release, you won't get this happening. And geez, I thought I had another slide for that. Yeah, that's the question was, what's the difference between acquire release and sequential consistency? Z can be 0. Sorry, I don't think I explained that very well, sorry. We've got more examples coming. So that's kind of the difference between your various things. And let's take a look at store, and let's not take a look at store and load. Oh, store and load uses those. Exchange, see where I'm going here. So let's just try to use exchange as, we had store and load, we understand what they do. Exchange sets the value and returns the old value. So let's just use a little Boolean exchange to make kind of like a lock, like we were talking about, can I make locks out of this? So we set it to true and see what it was. If it was 0, that means no one else had set it before us. We've got the lock, we can do stuff with it, and then we can set it back to false. So the other threads would probably be spin locking or this, or maybe they just come in and go, oh, I can't get it, I'll go off and do something else or whatever. But the weird part about this is, if it already was true when you come to here, then you set it to true, it already was true, big deal. But you see that the old value was true, meaning someone else got there before you, you can't get into this, there's an if statement there, you skip over the exclusive thing. So that's basically what exchange is all about. And that's how you do a really cheap kind of locking scheme. Or if that's all you're doing, you can use, that's where the atomic flag comes in. Instead of using atomic bool, atomic flag was built for this. You just do test and set, no parameters, and you clear it at the end. You can kind of see atomic flag was designed for exactly spin locks and cheesy things like that. So the question is, do I need sequential consistency there? Can I just use memory order acquire, memory order release? And I claim, yes, you can, and that's exactly what locks do. And I need know if I need to explain that. We'll just keep going. So this is a weird one. Oh, I really wish I could see the edge of my screen. That's a do while. It's not that hard. There's two compare exchange weak and compare exchange strong. So what's the difference? Not a lot. The problem being that compare exchange says, if the value was, whatever I think it was, set it to what I want it to be. Right? So if it was 0, set it to 1, but only if it was 0. If it's 17, don't change it. So I want to use this to do a counter, right? So I come in, I load the count, and put it in a little temporary variable. Say, okay, it was 17. And then I'm going to calculate that, well, I want it to be 18 next. And I say, if it's 17, make it 18. Now, I just read it. It was just 17 a second ago. That doesn't mean it's still 17 here, right? Because we are imagining lots of threads coming in and doing this. So I might come in and find out, no, it's not 17 anymore, it's 23. So, okay, well, if it's 23, I don't want to set it to 18. I'm trying to increment. So instead, come back around, magically, you know.
Compare exchange updates was.
Yes, compare exchange updates was. So even though it didn't set it, because I said, if it's 17, make it 18, it goes, no, no, man, I can't do that for you. But by the way, it's 23 now. So then you come back up here, and you say, okay, well, if it's 23, make it 24. And it comes in, it's, no, you're too slow. It's 32 now. So it's like you know, the idea is you want every vote to count, right? That's, you know, everyone gets a vote. Everyone vote gets everyone. Every vote counts. So your U.S. presidential elections. You're trying to vote for Obama, and you go in there and you say, wow, 500 people have voted for Obama. I want to vote for Obama. 501. What? 600 people have voted for Obama. Oh. 601, make it, and you keep going until eventually you get in there and you get your vote in there. Now, if you're voting for the other guy, it might have been a lot easier, right? 17 people vote, okay, yeah, 18. So.
Why not use an atomic increment?
Yes, I'm just happen to, why not use atomic increment? I'm just showing you basically how atomic increment works. Now, the nice part about using atomic increment is it can do a better job, because that might actually be one instruction in the processor. And basically, compare exchange does what I was saying. It checks what the value was, and if it's fine, it'll set it. Else, it'll return, let me know what the value is now. But it does all that atomically, right? And so here's an interesting, subtle difference. What we really want to do is tell me if it changed since the last time I read it, right? That's what we're trying to do. Like, I saw it was 500. If it's still 500, make it 501, right? So you could think of it working this way. If it hasn't been touched, change it for me. And it turns out it doesn't work that way. And believe it or not, there's a difference between these two. Although some processors, like PowerPCs, can work this way, and it's kind of nice because it can just tell you, it, there's differences. This is called load link store conditional, and we basically didn't go with that model in our standard, which for subtle reasons is unfortunate, because if I could know that between here and here it didn't change at all, you'll see maybe later that would be handy. So the other interesting thing about this that I should mention, the difference between weak, maybe I say this later, I forget, between difference between weak and strong. The weak one says, you know, was it the same as what I expected it to be? It can say, I don't know. It might be the same value, but I can't tell you right now. So it's just going to return false. And that's called spurious failure. For whatever reason it wants, it can say, I don't know, but here's the number for you. Compare exchange strong says, I don't want these headaches. Just give me a real answer. And the only difference being, some processors work this way, compare exchange weak, because of the way cache lines work. It can just say, well, the cache changed, so I'm just going to say false, whether the value is different or not. It kind of gives somewhat, it's for processors that work this way, it's a little easier for them to just say false in an atomic way. So a processor that does this natively can do that by putting its own loop inside the strong way. It can just say, it returned false, you know, loop around, return the spurious failure. And compare exchange weak and strong take two memory orderings, and for some reason I'm going to claim I need acquire release and relaxed here. And these are what happens in this case and what happens in that case. So you're saying if I'm setting it, I want maybe acquire release semantics. If I didn't set it, I just need relaxed semantics. I just want to read it. I'm not doing anything fancy. Just read the value for me. And the difference is on the relaxed case, you're just going to loop around and do it again anyhow. You're not going anywhere. You don't need to publish any state to anyone because you never did write anything. But if you are successful, you'll leave this loop and you'll want, you know, someone's relying on this count here. So you want your thread that was going down and setting count to 23, you want another thread that comes in and reads it to have a matching synchronization point. You only get a synchronization point if you use acquire release or sequential consistency, right? So as someone mentioned, why not just use count plus plus or fetch add? That would be a lot easier. So the only reason it's nice to do the loop is if your loop isn't just adding and it's doing some funky add, but don't go off the bounds. You know, you need your own. I typically call this a CAS loop because compare exchange is often spelled CAS, CAS for compare and swap or whatever it used to be called. So if you're doing anything fancy, trying to figure out what the next value should be, you're going to have to do that. But if you're just adding, you can use the instructions that are built in for you. So we've got these parts here. Let's do some actual lock-free programming. And yes?
Can you tell me how much of the X86 is X86?
How much of this exists on X86? How much lock-free you get out of X86? Okay, yeah. So how does x86 fit into all this stuff? Good and bad, x86 is one of the most forgiving memory models. And unfortunately, that means you can write a lot of code that's actually broken, and it'll work fine on x86, right? Because when you have these cases where you set x, and the other thread reads x, you put the wrong, certain parts of the, I said I just want to write this relaxed. Everything on x86, all your writes are ordered anyhow, or whatever. Like, it's very forgiving, and there's a good example. Oh, double check locking. Double check locking, which maybe if I'm lucky enough to have slides later, I forget. But double check locking is hey, is this thing been initialized yet? Oh, if it hasn't been initialized, grab a lock, initialize it, blah, 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 go on your way. There's actually a bug in double check locking. If you go look it up in Java or in C++, Alexandrescu and Scott Myers wrote, the dangers of double check locking, the perils of double check locking. So if those two guys write a paper called The Perils of Something, you should probably not do it. The reason why no one noticed that double check locking is broken is because it works fine on x86, unfortunately. Yes.
So you're actually not safe by x86 because there's the compiler which is going to reorder things.
Yes. Yes. So the compiler can reorder things as well.
So they have to conspire to obey the memory model.
Yeah, and a lot of stuff I showed was, what the processor might be doing to your code at any time. And the processor works in this model of I'm the only processor and single threaded world. The compiler works the same way. The compiler is free to move stuff around on you, figuring the as-if rule. You won't notice if I reorder these couple of instructions here. And we actually, when we finally got a threading model in C++ 11, there's a couple of things compilers used to do that suddenly they were not allowed to do anymore because it subtly breaks things.
I think the one other thing to note is x86-64 doesn't have the same guarantees.
x86-64 doesn't have the same guarantees. No, probably not. And the hardest part with a lot of Intel stuff is they really, really didn't want to give out a spec on exactly what their memory model was. And the whole world has figured out their memory model, but they're always like, can you verify that, what we're doing is the real model and stuff like that? So anyhow, let's do some, let's have some fun now. We want to push a value onto a lock-free stack. And the stack is very simple. We got a head, points to the next one, points to the next one. And then we want to pop it. I'm really going to try to. So what's this push going to look like? Well, first thing we do is allocate a new node. That's pretty normal. And we'll get the local variable to what the head was at. And we can point the node to the thing after the head there, so it's ready to go get sliced into the list here. And what we want to do is, you know, just point the head there, and then we've added it to our stack, right? Simple. Except it doesn't work if someone else is modifying the stack at the same time. So this is like, you know, single-threaded stack. And it doesn't work because between the call to stack head and the call to here, the whole world may have changed, right? In particular, we want this to point to that second node there, but it might be gone by the time you come around here and hook us up. So let's see if we can fix this little problem. And oh, lo and behold, remember this? You know, my CAS loop here. Let's reuse that same kind of CAS loop, but this time we're going to do something else inside of there. So that's the giant diagram there. We set up our stuff. We set up the node, get everybody set up, and we try to, number three there, we do the CAS. We try to say the head was pointing up to node, make it point to the new node. But what we do is, we say, wait a second, we've got it all set up. Only switch from old node to new node if at the point of the switch it's still pointing to the old node. Right? This guarantees us that the head hasn't, nothing has changed on us when we stuck the new node in there, right? So that step three there, dotted line becomes green line, happens atomically, and you know that it was pointing to where you thought it was pointing. And if it turns out it wasn't pointing there because node number, old node one suddenly, you know, if the whole stack got changed on you, you'll loop around and try again, reset yourself up, insert yourself again. So that, let's see if I got any more. Oh yeah, the only other question is, what memory orderings do you want here? I'm going to claim this can be relaxed because you'll never get anywhere. This isn't going to synchronize with any other thing in another in your code in another thread. This is when you synchronize, right? Once you get this new node put into the stack, you're basically new node was a local variable basically. Only you knew about it. So once you get it in the stack, you've published it to the rest of the world. When you publish something, you use memory order release. Say, here you go, everyone. If you're worried, just put sequential consistent everywhere, you know, but that's like a hammer. Yep, just a second. Yep.
So here, the thing about the CDP is who guarantees that new head next will be published to another thread at the time when you set the new head? Is it even possible that the new node still points to someone else?
So who guarantees? Okay, I'm not sure I'll repeat the question, but see if I can explain. It's basically, you know, where do we get to synchronize with and everything?
So probably I can try to explain. Imagine that a second thread reads head and creates that it points to a new node.
So a second thread comes in, and are you thinking like right here after I've done this, or during, after? So a new thread comes in, sees head, and reads the new node.
Exactly.
And will it see like a stale value of head, or will it?
New head next.
You're worried about this one?
Yes.
Because there's no acquire release or anything on this. There's no atomic operation. This one does, right? So this does half the happens before relationship. The last instruction we do is release, right? So we're saying, back in the diagram with the, you know, past and future, we're saying we've published everything that's happened here, not just the head pointer. We've also published this memory write, all the memory that we've written. And you have to think of new node. Maybe node has, you know, it has a value, right? You some thing you're putting into the stack. All those writes into that memory location, everything has happened. And you're saying, it's all happened, I'm going to publish it to the world. That is still only half of the synchronized relationship. The other guy who wants to go, okay, now I want to see what's in the at the top of the list, top of the stack, he has to do a memory order acquire to guarantee that, you know, it's not enough that you wrote it in order, he has to read it in order, right? So yeah, we're going to need an acquire on the other side. Which you'd be tempted to say this should be an acquire then, because, you know, we are also the guys reading someone else's work. But it doesn't need to be acquire there because it'll get resolved here. Because it's like,
well, and you're not looking inside the node that old head points to, like the other guy's going to.
Well, so before we got into here, someone else pushed, you know, another thread pushed, and it said, here's everything I know. Push, you know, the whole state is set. So when I come in, I better acquire to see that state properly. Otherwise, I can see old stuff or whatever. It's not the proper way to describe it, but let's just call it that. So I come in now and I read old stuff. I might read, you know, an unsynchronized head, but I will try to use that to do my calculations. And then when I go here to say, hey, is it the same thing it used to be? It'll go, no, man, that thing you got was old. That was years ago. And then I'll come back up here, and eventually I'll get the right value. So I don't.
You're being very optimistic. It's a very optimistic approach, as opposed to a pessimistic approach.
Yeah. It's tempting to say, it depends what the code outside of here is doing, too.
Yeah.
The code outside of here is doing a push. After the push, does it expect to do, you know, does it expect to read the, does it expect, you don't normally, on a push, expect to see the state of the other threads, because you're just pushing out. But, you know, if you were really worried about making sure you saw everything, you could put an acquire release on here. You could still be relaxed there and do acquire release on that one. But whatever the rest of the code's doing, if it's going to read, it's going to have to do its own acquire. Yes?
Doesn't the slide second the old head assignment need to go inside the loop? Wouldn't it end in a loop if someone else changed the head?
This gets updated inside the.
Oh,
that's a little trick. Oh, yeah. The question was, what about old head? Doesn't it get stale and you could just, you know, because it got last, it looks like it was last set here, but really old head is getting set here on failure. So look at this, enjoy this, because this is the simplest lock-free algorithm ever. It doesn't get any simpler than that. In fact, you know, let's try to pop from the stack, because even popping from the stack is harder than pushing to the stack. So we'll start out the same way. We you know, get a temporary variable of where the head was when we last looked, when we just looked at it, and we want to get rid of that first node there, and we're going to have to skip along to the next node because this will become the new one, right? That's we want that to be the new head. So we step along, and already we're in problems, right? We can't just walk over. We have to you know, check that there is another node to go to, and if it's null, we can like throw or something like that, right? And okay, if it's not null, then we'll go and make that. We want that second node there. So, any problems with that? Yeah. Oh, it's not null. Now it is null, right? So right there is a problem. And guess what? I'm not even going to solve that problem. I'm just going to wave my hands, because that's not even the funnest problem of popping from a stack. Let's imagine that, Can I have my, can we go forward again? Oh, right, I've got a little, can't see it, it's off the edge. So yeah, basically there's a little saying, yeah, the problem's in there. The one way to not worry about the head being null is to do your own allocation and freeing and stuff like that, and manage your free pointers in magical ways. And there's all these crazy ways to get rid of that problem. But anyhow, let's imagine that we got away with checking for null here, not worry about that problem, and we want to now do the same idea where node was pointing up there. We switch it now to point to the second node. Or like head was pointing to the first node, we CAS it to switch it to the second node. CAS is the compare exchange, right? And if it fails, we'll set it all up and try again. Same sort of thing, right? Oh yeah, and here's my, after you've popped it, you recycle it. You don't delete it. That's why I can say that this isn't null, because we recycle our pointers, right? Something like that. So that looks fine, right? It's the same idea as the push. If it doesn't work the first time, you reset everything up and you loop around until you get it in there. So unfortunately that doesn't work. And let's take a look why that doesn't work, because it's lovely. So there's an arrow here. Let's go about this far along in our algorithm, right? We've done this. We've got everything set up. Our state is like that diagram there. Everybody's ready to go. And then let's say, we go to sleep for a few hours, a few days. The whole world changes between every line of code, right? And what happens is those two nodes get deleted and new nodes get added instead, right? So then we wake up and we try to do our CAS and we'll go, whoa, 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 head's not what I expected it to be, right? So there, the compare exchange is going to fail. It's going to go, that's not right. And it's going to loop around, right? You're like, oh, great. No problem. It worked exactly like I wanted it to work. So, okay, that time it did. Now let's say we do this again. We come through here. We stop here. And we take an hour nap. And this time, we put some new nodes in there. The old nodes get deleted. And then let's say that old node gets recycled in our allocator, because guess what? Memory's not infinite. You actually have to reuse pointers memory eventually after you give it, calling delete means it can be reused. So let's say all the time we're waiting here, that node that was deleted gets put back in as another value into our thing, right? So just be clear about that. It got deleted. The pointer, the memory location got reused by the allocator. And now we've got this situation, and we're still right here. And we wake up and we go, oh yeah, awesome. The head's exactly what it used to be. So I will hook up my new node. And these four nodes just get lost, just tossed away. Does everyone see that? Right? Head is exactly what we thought it was when we started, but we didn't see all these new nodes get added. So what this is called the ABA problem, right? Compare exchange has this thing saying, what you're doing is saying, is it the same thing it was last time I looked at it? And it goes, oh yeah, the head's still A. It was B for a while, and we did a bunch of stuff, and now it's back to A again. That other stuff that happened when it was B might be important. So you're trying to use is it still A to mean nothing has happened. And it doesn't mean that. It means something might have happened, but this one pointer is back to where it used to be. And remember how I talked about this? That's the difference between these two cases. Checking that your count or your pointer or whatever is the same thing it used to be a while ago is one thing. If you could check, has it really changed? Has it ever changed? Has it gone to B and back to A? That would be so much nicer. If we had this, we wouldn't get this ABA problem, because it would say, oh, it's A now, and it used to be A before, but it was B in between. And some processors can tell you that. Yet in the C++ standard, we didn't give you this instruction. We only gave you that instruction. So your lock-free stacks don't work very well. Yeah?
I've been playing around with a problem recently similar. Is any way do you think that you can tell the difference between ABA and AAA? Or are the two just, you just have to assume it's ABA? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah? So the question is, can I tell the difference between ABA and AAA? And so the processors that do this probably can't tell, right? They would say AAA, hey, it changed. It got written again. Got written to the same value, but it got written again. I'd have to think about that one.
I didn't mean to break this.
No, it's perfect because you weren't here at the very beginning, were you? You were hiding or something. I showed your slides again. The IBM slides are his slides.
No,
so.
No. You have all my permissions to do anything you want.
We're like 20 minutes or so? Okay. So, it's tempting to say, exercise for a reader how to fix this problem. But, there's a number of ways to fix it. One of the ways is to take all your pointers, and if they're 32-bit values or whatever, make them 64-bit values, and hope that your processor does 64-bit atomic operations, and stick a count on your pointers, so that you won't see ABA, you'll see ABA primed, as every pointer has a unique value to it. You just always increment this counter on your pointer values. If your pointers are already 64-bit, well, now you need a 96 or 128-bit atomic operation. Yeah, yeah, just throw more at it, right? That's always the answer. So that's the main gist of things. And just quickly, my whole point here was to scare you to not use, my point was to use locks, right? Don't do any of this code. So just to continue the scare, I've got R1 and R2. We load, one loads Y, one loads X. Y gets set to 42 after loading X, and X gets stored R1, whatever came out of Y. And we assert that R1 and R2 equal 42. And these are all relaxed loads, right? So how did this happen? Does this make sense to anyone? Are you comfortable with this happening? So
it's allowed to reorder, isn't it?
Yeah. So this is the point, though, right? That over here, you saw you loaded X and then you stored Y, but maybe the compiler or the processor decided to go, no, I'm going to store Y first and then load X. And same with over here, it could reorder these things. But your mental model of things is usually A happens and then B happens, A happens and then B happens. So in a sequential model, you'll never get this occurrence. In a non-sequential relaxed model, you'll get things like this that, you're writing your code and you think you know what's going on, and then you realize, wait a second, how did I get into this state, right? So that's just one, it's just a tiny example of, all these problems. This is my favorite. So we check if P is not null, whatever, and then we do this, *P, x equals *P. We already know that if you check for P equal to null and then do a next step, things could change between that, right? Like that's a dangerous, every time you do an if and then an instruction, things could happen in between. This is two instructions, read P, dereference P. Things could happen in between, right? So that's scary. Better yet, processors like Michael's back there can dereference P before reading P. Everyone okay with that? In essence, it can dereference P before reading P. It can dereference, it can do them out of order. It can reorder that. So how, for years, all I did with this is say, I don't want to know how this works. The alpha processor, DEC alpha used to work this way. Some of your PowerPCs work this way, right?
Still do.
Still worked out, yeah. So that's why there's this, I didn't even mention it before, there's a memory order consume if you want to say, all I'm doing is dereferencing the pointer and I don't want this craziness to happen, use memory order consume. So for years, I just didn't think about how this could possibly happen. But I've read on deck alpha how it happens. And it's got like even line, cache lines and odd cache lines and all this crazy stuff. And it's like, OK, I thought of a way that, at least in my mind, I don't know if this happens, but it makes me feel reasonable about life. Imagine over here you have foo, you set it to 42, and then foo is some, you know, maybe it's a static inside your code, but you want to publish the pointer to foo, right? So we say, okay, now the pointer to foo is p, and p is some global variable that the other guy is going to read, right? So I think I have one more step here. Let's say it just so happened that this guy was also messing with bar before he read p. And let's say on the cache line, we have p is here, and it points to foo, and foo and bar are on the same cache line. Right? So now this processor comes along, it reads bar, whoosh, sucks in this whole cache line, and then comes in and wants to read p. And it does, you know, it reads p and sees that p points over to here and it goes, oh, I just read that cache line a second ago. I don't need to reread it. So, I mean, it did read the pointer first and then dereference it. But what you're seeing is a dereference of the old value of foo. So in a sense, it dereferenced first and then read the pointer, right? Just because it happened to be on the same cache line, you know. It's like, oh, I've already read that from memory. I'm not going to read it from memory again. I've got it right here locally, right? So I imagine maybe that's how that stuff happens, but there's other ways you can get those things happening. And that's just, that to me is one of the scarier things that happen if you don't use locks. So use locks. And then you try to assert that x equals 42, and what you might end up finding is that you've got, you know, not 42 in the old value, right, instead. One other thing to mention, just quickly, false sharing. Let's say we got, you know, some kind of lock-free list or something. It's got next and prev pointers, maybe. And you do atomic operations on it, right? You do atomic operations on the next. You do atomic operations on prev. And you've got this struct here with your two atomic pointers. And you'd say, oh, I'm going to make this all lock-free. It'll be faster. It'll be better. Everyone will be happy. But note that these two things are side by side in memory, probably, right? Which means that they're probably on the same cache line when you're doing stuff with it. Oops, back up. So every time you do an atomic operation on next, you're basically stalling the atomic operation on prev. Even though they're two separate variables, at the bottom, what the processor's doing to do all this atomic stuff tends to be dealing with cache lines. And so what you get is two atomic things that bump into each other, and that's called false sharing. You think, oh yeah, this is going to be fast because I'm only working on next, and oh, this code's doing something completely different on prev, but they're bumping into each other all the time.
Isn't that why you just pack?
Yeah, this is why you pack, yeah. Just put a gap between these things. Put a bunch of crap in there. Herb Sutter's got a really good article on like timings of how much worse things get if you get false sharing in there. This was an interesting topic at the end of last year. Atomic T is implemented with locks when T is too big to be naturally atomic, right? Locks use acquire-release semantics. I didn't really prove that or anything. You just have to trust me on that. But atomic T offers sequential consistency. How do you implement sequential consistency if you only have acquire-release to work with? I'm not going to answer that question. So, like, you know, these are not equal. Right? I did show that with Michael's slides, right? They're scary. For a while I was worried that it was actually not possible, and we had written the standard really badly, and oh my God, what have we done, kind of thing. But I think it's okay. I think there's ways of doing it. But I mean, one way to do it is to have a big giant lock, one lock for everything, right? But hopefully it's not quite that bad. I think that was just a reminder of reminder of how scary things can get, and a reminder of some slides were stolen. Oh, this is Michael's slide of how he borrowed slides from other people. And thanks to Michael and these whole list of people who Hans is on the committee and done a lot of this, a lot of the threading stuff. This is the guy I stole stuff from on the web. Bartosz, he's here most years. He's got a great website and blog that he talks about threading a lot. Now he talks about Haskell all the time, but for a while he was talking about threading a lot. Anthony Williams has a whole library of, he's got the boost, he's all the boost thread stuff, right? This guy's pretty brilliant on comp programming threads. If you ever want to know of how many different ways you can write like a lock-free queue, like, you know, there's about 100. And some more people like borrowed stuff off in the slides. And use locks. And any questions, I think, basically? And you can read over that while if anyone has any questions. And the last, the only thing I'm changing is how to learn atomics in 21 days. Yes?
Yeah, just a note about Microsoft's implementation of atomics.
Yeah.
So you're using relaxed atomics and you notice that you don't get a performance benefit. That's because they don't do relaxed atomics. All loads are a cast loop.
Oh, wow.
And you can actually implement them as just a load, like a move queue, with compiler barriers. But yeah.
You're supposed to hold up the sign. Tell me to answer. Yeah, what he's saying is that Microsoft's implementation of atomics is currently not the best. It's doing CAS loops for all, even for relaxed loads and stuff like that, when it doesn't need to do all that.
They're using quantum release semantics?
They're using sequentially consistent semantics for every load operation.
They're using
most operations except for store.
So they're being very safe and secure.
This is safe, yeah. So I think that is generally a first attempt implementation by a lot of people because it is turning out to be exceedingly difficult. Although I didn't think it was that case on Intel, but certainly on our processor to make relax work properly.
Shouldn't relax just work? Like just do a load?
Barriers, because otherwise it can split the load into multiple loads.
The load can be split into multiple loads. Yeah, okay.
It's not atomic.
Yeah.
GCC 4.6 had the same problem. The atomics on GCC 4.6 were all full barrier. 4.7 introduces the relaxed.
Okay, so basically I think what's happening is the compilers are catching up. What you should do is write your code assuming everything's pretty, and the compilers will eventually get their implementations better. What you should really do is write your code with locks and don't worry about anything at all.
Just because it works, don't assume that it's right.
There's a whole thing with threading, and especially lock-free code, is how do you know it's correct? And the more lock-free stuff you do, it's like, I can't test that it's correct, because your tests will never find all the race conditions, right? There's the Dimitri guy there, he's got a thing called Relacy that will do race detection, and there's a few other things out there that'll try to do race detection for you. But I had, at Adobe, we tried to write a mostly lock-free allocator. And it ran, you know, it would run for a week before it had a bug. And it came down to two lines of code. It was basically inside a CAS loop. And it's that same idea. It was like it's a stack and the head and all this kind of stuff. And it was like, how is this null? How is this not working? And it's like, it's one of two lines of code. And two of us stared at two lines of code for a couple of hours, just not saying, every now and then one of us would go, oh, maybe this is, no, that's not it. That's not it. So unless you like doing that kind of thing, I would, I don't do lock-free programming at work. It's a hobby. I do it here mostly. And it's, I like it because you can get small problems that fit in your head that you don't need to write down or anything, you can just think about. Like, and basically come to the next talk where I do one small lock-free problem. which much better talk than this one in a half hour. But yeah, you can't test threading code and lock free code, and you can't look at it and know that it's correct. You have to get a whole pile of people to look at it. The other case is a project. Look up the Ptolemy project, which they did the whole part. One of the things of the whole project was, let's do all best practices. Let's do the code reviews. Let's do the unit tests. Let's do testing. Let's do everything right. And they're writing like a kernel and all this kind of stuff. And they got their system out and running. And 4 years later, it deadlocked. It took 4 years before the race condition was found.
So then it worked.
Well, you know, in a sense, it worked for 4 years. You know, you get a deadlock once every 4 years. Reboot the server. What, you know, like, maybe that's not that bad, right? Depends what the server's doing, of course, you know. Heart monitor or something, like, whatever.
Probably had a memory error.
No, they looked at it, and it was a bug in their code.
Okay.
It was a bug in their code that showed up once every 4 years. An ECC machine for lock free,
yes.
So you don't get the random.
Maybe one memory error every 2 days on the regular machine.
Yeah, they get the same question, like I mentioned before, where sometimes you put counters inside your pointers,
yeah,
to make sure they're different than the last time you looked at it. That wraps around every 2 to the 32, right?
Yes.
4 billion. And you're like, well, that's fine. That's never going to happen. It's like, okay, wait a second. I got a 4 gigahertz machine. It wraps around every second. Okay? If it's doing nothing else, right? But so I know some people who don't like that answer of like, no, 32 bits of you know, that's not good enough. But depends what your system is doing, right? Any more? I can just sit in here and talk all day, but no, good. Perfect. We're good. Thank you. Thank you all.